this theater is so intimidating to me. I was here early and I looked around and I felt terrified. I thought, this is like for ballet or something. Anyway, can you all hear me well? Good. Thanks so much, Reggie. That was a nice reunion to have backstage. And thanks to Roberta, and thanks to Janet Crow and everybody from the university who made this trip possible. This is an awfully nice part of America. This town, Florence, is a very special place, and I've been here a few times before, but today I actually had a chance to walk around a little, and it feels kind of like utopia compared to the parts of the country that I write about. And I'm very grateful to people who made me welcome here. And I'm especially welcome to some students who came to my hotel last night and kept me up late. Some really nice students from CCO, Chris Hess and Jennifer McAdam, and some others who are working with homeless people here in Lawrence. And they're with us tonight and can talk with you later in the lobby. I promised them I would announce that they're holding a banquet for homeless people on Tuesday night at the Ecumenical Center. So I hope you'll all go there. And I know there are a lot of teachers here tonight. I've met quite a few of you the past day and a half since I arrived here in various smaller sessions. And I also know that there's some real live school principals here too, and students from high school. And I'm just glad you're here. And I'm especially grateful to the school teachers who are here tonight, the regular public school teachers, especially the ones who work with little children in the elementary schools. They are my heroes. Those are the people I admire most in the United States. They don't get paid much, they don't get much respect, they never did, but I think they do the best thing there is to do on earth, which is to bring joy and magic, love and courage to the hearts of little pint-sized people. The happiest times I've spent in my life were as a fourth and fifth grade teacher. And every time I visit a fourth and fifth grade classroom, I feel so jealous that they're not my kids, that they're the teacher's kids instead. I have this dream that if I'm not completely senile in about 5 years, I'm gonna go back into an elementary school somewhere and do it all over again. I'd love to go back this time and teach kindergarten, first grade. If I do, however, I don't want to teach in any voucher school or any charter school or any other little private and elitist school. I call them boutique schools because their purpose isn't really to improve the public schools by competition. It's to build some little isolated lifeboats for the privileged and relatively privileged. And I oppose the voucher movement in all forms with all my heart because it represents a dagger in the heart of our American ideal of democratic education. And I beg you not to underestimate the power and determination of the advocates for vouchers. They're the same people who tried to resist Brown versus Board of Education back in the 1950s when they started so-called Christian academies, freedom of choice schools, they called them. And they were anything but Christian, of course, in their real intentions. They're the same people who have repeatedly opposed Head Start and Medicaid and food stamps and all the good things that poor children need in our country. These privatizing forces, however, are very shrewd and very tough and very mean and clever and well organized. And I know this because I have to debate them. You know, every TV panel show needs one liberal. So if the other If the other six are dead, they call me. And I do it, and you know, and these are awfully smart people, and they're not just you know, rough, unsophisticated rednecks. These are people from big right-wing foundations who know what they're doing, and they're very well prepared. And there's a real type. I don't like to stereotype anybody, but in this case, there really is a type. They tend to be young, white, thin, male, and they use words with surgical efficiency. They use words to kill, and they're good at it. They're sort of like micro versions of George Will, the same spooky glasses, and these are tough guys, and I can tell you they're not nice people. Usually when you debate on television before you go out in front of the camera, you sit in some little dressing room and even adversaries chat with each other, you know, and try to be friendly. Not these guys. They sit there going through their index cards, and it's like watching a verbal homicide in preparation, you know. And there are a lot of them. I don't know where they come from, but you push down one, another one pops up. They're just, I sometimes think they have a farm team somewhere, up in New Hampshire probably, at the Dartmouth Review, and they ship them from there straight to the Heritage Foundation so they can poison the clean air of our good country. And I want to tell you, friends in Kansas, we've got to start a farm team of our own if we want to win this fight, because these guys are well organized. I've had a lot of chance to look at the faces of the students here the past few days. I just look at them, and they look so young to me. And as you were coming in tonight, I was peeking around the curtain thinking, my God, they're getting younger and younger and younger. And the truth is, I am old compared to most of you. I was 63 years old 2 months ago, and I have to admit that I feel kind of old. And sometimes, to be honest, I feel kind of lonely because I live all by myself in a little house in the woods in Massachusetts with nobody except my dog. There's a nice dog, too, and name is Sweetie Pie, and she's a beautiful dog. I wish she could have come with me today. She's smart, kind, compassionate, theologically profound. But she's a dog, and I get lonely. The birthday that was really hard to face was 3 years ago when I was 60. And all you young folks, you won't want to be 60 either. Almost everyone I knew forgot me that year. I got a visit from a priest. As a very loyal friend of mine, except for that, I was alone. But when I went out to get the mail that day, I found this birthday card right here from a little boy in the South Bronx named Elio, a 7-year-old whose face is very round, looks like a light brown olive with a smile painted on it. He's a sweet little boy. It was the only birthday card I got. My publisher forgot. My editor forgot, my mother forgot. But Elio remembered. I'm very grateful for this card. I carry it with me everywhere I go. Whenever I struggle to fight off despair and weariness, I think of Elio, and I thank God for giving wise hearts to small children. I've spent most of my life working with kids like Elio. I started out back in 1964, as Reggie just mentioned, 35 years ago this fall, in the segregated public schools of Boston. I had no training as a teacher. I went to Harvard, and I walked into the Boston public schools, said, I'm going to be a teacher. They said, where'd you go to college? I said, Harvard. They said, then you can't be a teacher, because you couldn't get certified at Harvard. And I said, is there no way I could teach? They said, well, you could be a sub. So I became a substitute teacher. And first time I ever taught in my life, I was sent to teach advanced German at an all-black high school. I'd never studied German in my life. They said, it doesn't matter, just do anything. And the second week I taught kindergarten in South Boston, which is a white neighborhood. And I walked in and saw all these little creatures. I was terrified. These little things. To me, they were like gerbils. And no idea what you do with people that size. I just let them crawl all over me, and I patted them, but I survived. And I've spent most of the decade since working in one way or another with black or Hispanic children, much of the past 6 years off and on in New York City in the South Bronx. In all, I've made about 200 visits up to the South Bronx to talk with children, mothers, fathers, preachers, and teachers who face problems I couldn't even dream of 30 years ago. I go up usually on the train, the number 6 train. If you're in Manhattan, you can take the same trip. Get on in front of Bloomingdale's at 59th Street in Lexington, the richest section of the richest population quadrant probably in the entire Western world. You get off 14 minutes later at Brook Avenue in the South Bronx, poor section of the poorest congressional district in the nation. Also, one of the most unhealthy places physically for a child to grow up anywhere in the Western world. Pediatric AIDS was common when I first visited the neighborhood, less so now because of perinatal interventions. Maternal AIDS was common and still is. That neighborhood has the highest rate of HIV infection among young adult women in the United States. Chronic depression among children in the neighborhood is common. Asthma is endemic among children. I don't know why, but it seems like every third or fourth child in the neighborhood start talking to you about something that's at all emotionally loaded and starts to wheeze, and then you see the child reach nervously into her pocket or his pocket to see if they have their pump with them. That's what they call the asthma inhaler. It's a little yellow-orange pump, which you see everywhere in the neighborhood. It's extraordinary to see so many people unable to breathe. And I don't think it's purely a matter of environmental factors, though that's one big reason, because where does American society put smelly, unhealthy installations like waste burners? You put them in poor neighborhoods or minority neighborhoods. But I think it's more than that. I think it's also psychological pressure. I think there's a lot of emotional tension in that neighborhood, a sense of suffocating within. After I'd been there about 4 months, I developed chronic asthma. Went back to Boston, saw my doctor. She said, well, you'll have to have a pump too. So I said, could I have a yellow one? So this, the children, I have it, carry it everywhere now. A lot of the kids in the neighborhood don't have their fathers at home because so many of their fathers are in prison. I like to be very careful not to stereotype any community. There are plenty of law-abiding men in that neighborhood who manage to do well against the odds. Still, I'd say about a quarter of the children that I know see their father only when they visit him in prison, about 25%. The prison of New York City is called Rikers Island. It's an island out in the East River. Anytime you fly into New York, if you fly into LaGuardia, you go right over Rikers Island. You sit on the right side of the plane and look out the window, and just before the wheels touch down, you're looking at the largest prison colony in the entire world, and almost entirely black and Hispanic inmate population. women out there too. So many women that there's a nursery and babies are born out there. There's a breathtaking view of Rikers Island from the rooftop of one of the buildings that I visit in the South Bronx. You can't see the Statue of Liberty from the South Bronx, but you can see the prison all too clearly. And it is, of course, a totally segregated neighborhood. Little elementary school I used to visit when I first came into the neighborhood, not so little actually, had 800 children packed into that school. I asked the principal, how many white kids are there in this school? He said, one child. One white child out of 800. I wanted to meet the teacher who had that one white child. So I went down to her classroom, I think it was a third grade. And, you know, I'm very grateful that teachers are honest with me and don't talk to me as though I were a journalist, because I'm not a journalist. I don't view myself as a journalist. They treat me as a friend. And even if we've never met, they treat me as though we had met long ago, because they feel we've been in the same struggle. And so when I ask teachers questions, they usually tell me the truth. I said to her, how many white kids have you taught over the years? She took me by the arm. I don't know why, people always do this with me. She took my elbow and like squeezed it hard. And she said, Jonathan, I've been in this school for 18 years. This is the first white student I've ever had. Just extraordinary, absolute apartheid. These kids go for years and years and years and never know white children. I talk about this all the time. Nobody else does. It's not in fashion anymore. Even black folks hardly speak of it any longer because, you know, they've beaten their head against that wall for so darn long, they're not going to do it anymore. But I talk about it, not to black people, naturally. Every so often I do. Sometimes I'm in a school, like a high school in the Bronx, where I've never seen a white student. And I sort of forget the demographics while I'm there. I mean, you know, you don't walk into a school and say, today I am in a segregated school. No, you see kids in front of you. But at some point during the day, it dawned on me, I must have been watching the kids walking through the corridor or something, and I thought, this is just like those movies they show on public television to remind us of what it was like in the old days in Mississippi. This is what it looked like. And so I'll go to the principal, if it's a black principal, and I'll say, would you call this a segregated school? And it's funny the way the principal will react. These are black principals I've known for years. And they kind of look at me with this smile slowly coming out in their face. And it's like nobody says this anymore. And they smile at me and they say, you know, Jonathan, it never comes up anymore, but that's what this is, of course. This is segregation. This is it. I don't usually discuss it with black people, but I bring it up with white people all the time in New York City. You know, it's very easy to be in New York and talk about what's wrong with Chicago, or be in Chicago and talk about racial segregation in Milwaukee. But I think we have an obligation to tell the truth about the place we are. So when I'm in New York, I try to talk about New York, and I still have some white friends in New York, you know, like people who went to college with me years ago, or people of my generation who have pretty powerful jobs now in New York. You know, if you went to Harvard in the 1950s and didn't do something crazy like become a teacher, but did what your parents wanted you to do, like go to medical school, a law school, a business school, you'd have a lot of power today in New York. And some of these people are fond of me still. I don't know why. They still like me. They're nervous with me. They think I want to, take away their money. And I do, you know. And if I were the mayor, I would. But I'm not. But they like me anyway. And they invite me to lunch because they feel sorry for me. They see me looking sad because I'm worried about the children that I know, and they feel sorry that I'm sad. And they think I'm loaded with liberal guilt, you know. So, which I am. So, what do you do in New York if you want to comfort somebody who's suffering from liberal guilt? You take him out to lunch at the Four Seasons. And you spend more money for lunch than the kids I know would get in 2 months in food stamps. And we sit and talk, and I talk about New York. And I say, you know, this is a segregated system. And my friends get mad at me when I do that. And they get very defensive, because these old friends of mine in New York are liberals. Or actually, they're ex-liberals. They're tired, washed out ex-liberals. Neoliberals, they call themselves. And what they do when you talk about contemporary issues like this is to pull out their credentials from the 1960s. And it drives black people crazy when they do this. And what they do is, you know, they remind you of all the good things they did when they were idealistic and young, 30 years before. And they remember every march they went on. And they look me in the eyes and they say, "You remember me, Jonathan, I was there. I was with you. I was in the struggle." And they remember all the marches and say, "I was in Washington with Dr. King. I was at Greensboro. I was in Jackson." And then the jewel in the crown of liberal nostalgia. "I was on the bridge at Selma, Alabama," you know. I always think if all the ex-liberals who say they were on that bridge really were, it would have collapsed. But I like even better the words of a black teacher from Harlem who put it to me like this. "You see, Jonathan," he said, "to the very, very poor black and Latino kids I teach today in Harlem, it doesn't really matter all that much what bridge you stood on 30 years ago. They want to know what bridge you stand on now." And that's the question that America doesn't want to answer. Every year in January, everybody speaks about Dr. Martin Luther King. Isn't that when his birthday comes? I hope I have it right. And, you know, Martin Luther King Day, and even the right-wing politicians who hated him and opposed everything he stood for, quote him now. They are on television, "I have a dream." But that's all you hear. They never get beyond those words. They never tell you what the dream was. Even the black schools, I never see them go beyond those words. "I have a dream," and then it stops. I'm old enough to have heard Dr. King speak in person. Once, right in Boston Common, which is a scene of many, many important events in American history. From the Revolutionary War, once Dr. King came to Boston to speak in Boston Common in the mid-60s, and the black leaders asked me if I would like to be a bodyguard for Dr. King. Isn't that amazing, me? And I mean, I was this like skinny little thing from Harvard, you know, what your generation would call a dweeb. And they didn't need me to defend him. They had big guys to defend him. They just did that to be nice. It was a way of reaching out to white people. But you know, I remember that day, and I remember many other times hearing his words. And you know, I remember the rest of the sentence. Dr. King did not say, I have a dream that someday in the segregated cities of America, we will have ghetto schools with tougher standards and more punitive exams. Dr. King did not say, I have a dream that someday in the segregated sections of America, we will have site-based ghetto schools in which the kids wear uniforms and school officials churn out weary slogans about self-esteem. Dr. King did not say, I have a dream of pretty ghetto schools, or more utilitarian ghetto schools, or ghetto schools with vouchers that reward the children of the savviest and best-connected parents. He did not say, I have a dream of private ghetto schools, or little ghetto schools, or innovative ghetto schools with benchmarks and portfolio assessments. He did not dream of innovative segregation. His dream was absolutely clear. I have a dream that someday little black children and little white children will sit together at the table of brotherhood. It almost never happens in this country anymore. The more our shame, the more our sin, the more our national transgression. I mean, you go with me into any big inner city high school in St. Louis, Chicago, Milwaukee, Boston, or the Bronx. And you walk into schools that I visit every week when I'm in New York, 99.8% black and Hispanic in that neighborhood. And you tell me this modernized millennial apartheid is what Dr. King and all our other martyrs died for. Whether the issue is racial isolation or whether the form that segregation takes is mainly economic, as in many parts of Kansas. The separation of rich kids from poor, white kids from black and brown, whether in separate neighborhoods, in separate schools, or simply in separate tracks, in separate courses in the same school building. I regret this deeply. And I think it's a terrible betrayal of the best things that a good democracy should stand for. You know, in New York, I always hear the experts talking about the deficient values of poor children in the ghetto. And nobody ever talks about the deficient values of those who live at absolute peace, utter equanimity with absolute apartheid, and then go home at night and play their old Pete Seeger records and think they're liberals. Despite the many sad things that I've seen, I want to testify tonight that there are many miracles to be discovered in the poorest places in this nation. Those miracles are the resilient souls and beautiful spirits of small children who defy the ugly stereotypes of inner city life by their inherent decency and kindliness and capability for love. I know so many of these children who are nothing like any of the stereotypes you read about in sociology. I think of little Elio, who sent me my birthday card. He's a little kid. At least he was when I met him. He's bigger now. He was only 6 when we met. Tiny. Their kids would pick on him. They wouldn't punch him or anything. They would pick on him with words. And he's one of these sweet kids who doesn't have the gift of using words sarcastically. So that when people teased him, he would be disarmed because he would have no way to fight back with words. And he's an innocent little boy. He's just a good little boy. So when people pick on him, he doesn't know what to do. And he goes through what I would call like a two-stage reaction. I think of him like a two-stage rocket. First, he bursts into tears, pitiful tears, overheated tears. Then there's like a 20-second delay. Then he reaches back, he punches the kid in the nose, clobbers him hard, he's tough. And then he runs to the priest of the church and asks for a blessing. Now, this is in an after-school program at the end of the school day, where the kids go to be safe and to get instruction, tutorial instruction after school and to have supper. And it's an Episcopal church, so the priest happens to be a woman. The kids call her Mother Martha. He goes running to her, "Mother Martha, Mother Martha, will you give me a blessing so I won't fight anymore?" She says, "Elio, you don't need my blessing. You were blessed by God already." He says, "Could I have an extra one, just in case?" So she says, "Okay, wait a minute." And then she goes upstairs and disappears. She comes back a couple minutes later with this big silver bowl. And in this bowl is water. At least to me, it looks like water, but it's really holy water. Now, I'm Jewish, so I don't know where the water comes from, you know. I wish I knew. And I've asked her, and she won't tell me. And I asked Elio, "Where does it come from? Where does the holy water come from?" He thought for a long time once, and he said, "From a bottle?" And it's like, you know, like wine. Like, it could be like a good year for holy water, you know? And then he thought, and he said, "Maybe a special faucet." As though there were like an Episcopal water system. And I don't know where it comes from, but I want to tell everybody in this room that if you could see the smile on his face when Mother Martha sprinkles holy water on his head, you wouldn't have a doubt in the world but that that water really is holy. It's something to see, let me tell you. And the priest of this church is a marvelous woman, one of those rare human beings you meet every so often in this world, who is a true intellectual, but she has fun with children. And this is a woman who grew up in great privilege and went to Harvard University, Radcliffe College, when the women were separate from the men in the 1960s, and went to law school and became a junior partner in one of the most high-powered law firms in America. Her senior partner was a well-known lawyer named Louis Neiser, who many of you will remember, those of you who are my age. And you know, she was shooting right to the top because a high-powered lawyer with a sophisticated Ivy League education, who was also a woman, was set to crash through that glass ceiling. And then in the 1980s, her little brother, who was gay, died of AIDS in San Francisco. And she went out to bury him. And after he died, she had a vision from the gospel. A sophisticated woman. She took the same courses I took at Harvard. You know, she, just like me, she sat through those dreary lectures with Henry Kissinger and Arthur Schlesinger Jr. But she saw a vision that told her what to do with the rest of her life. And she went back to New York, she gave up the law, she went to seminary. And when she became a priest, she asked for the poorest congregation in New York. And despite all that, she has a sense of joy. And when she sprinkles holy water on the children, she doesn't just do it, you know, like with theological restraint. She really douses them, you know? There's this thing you do it with. Now, some of you who are real Christians, like those folks out in front, you know, you'd know what this thing is called. It has a Latin name, and I just keep forgetting it. But I just call it this big silver thing. And it's like a scoop. You know, she puts it in the holy water, and she goes like that, wham. And it just soaks him. And all the kids come running. There are like 80 little children who come here, and these are wonderful, sweet kids who want everything in life that your children want, and their mothers and fathers want the same things that all parents want for their children. They just don't have the means to give it to them. And these little kids, they're like little birds running to a fountain in the summertime to cool off. They come running across the room, Mother Martha, will you bless me too? Bless me, Mother, bless me. And they believe in that blessing, and they come running to her, and she lifts it up, and she shakes it wildly in all directions. And I look at her face, and suddenly she looks so young. She looks like an 8-year-old herself, and she's just beaming with happiness. She once said to me, of all the things I have to do, that's the part I love the most. Well, who wouldn't? And every time I see her doing it, I think, she's doing in that moment what a good society would do for all its children. These little kids don't get many blessings from America. The Congress doesn't bless them. President Clinton sure as hell didn't bless them when he signed that welfare bill. The mayor of New York City hasn't blessed them in a few hundred years. And the newspapers usually don't bless them except in the convenient weeks preceding Christmas, when they discover the beauty of poverty. Culture doesn't bless them. The economy doesn't bless them. The builders of prisons do not bless them. Their mothers bless them. Good teachers bless them. Their priest blesses them. Children learn to find their blessings where they can, and they return them to us in abundance. You know, some of the critics on the right, political right, don't like my books. They say that I like these kids too much and that I'm not objective. Well, I'm not. Let me testify tonight. I'm not objective in the least. You know, I am as partisan as I could be. I love these kids, and I'll fight for them the same way you'd fight for your own children. But sometimes, just to test my reactions, to see if I'm completely naive and romantic, I'll invite another grown-up to come with me, just to see how he or she reacts. Now, I don't do this too often, because it seems like everybody who read Amazing Grace wants to meet these children. And you know, you can't bring hundreds of thousands of people to peek at little children. And you can't put poor children on display. If you ever did that, their parents would resent it. But sometimes, if there's somebody wonderful I think they'd like to meet, I'll take a chance and let that grown-up come with me. I did it once for Reverend Jesse Jackson. He'd read the book, or his wife had read it, and he said, I'd like to meet these children. Do you think it would be okay if I did? And I said, I think it would be okay. And he went with me, and it was a wonderful time. He didn't bring a retinue of journalists with him. There were no TV cameras. There were no speeches, no rhymes. Just a really good human being, Jesse Jackson, a sensitive man listening to children, just listening to them, and seeming to be humbled in their presence. It's beautiful to see him in that setting. And I brought some conservatives with me. Yes, I have some Republican friends. Yes, I do. Quite a few in Kansas even. And I've brought a very conservative newscaster with me. I won't name him now, but he's a well-known, very well-known newscaster. He used to be a spokesperson for the White House, and he wanted to meet these kids, and he reacted the same way Jesse Jackson did, with humility, and a kind of almost as though he were filled with awe in their presence, as though he were in the presence of a mystery. Of all the grown-ups who have gone with me to meet the children, the one they liked the best was somebody I'll bet every single person in this room would love to spend a day with. A man named Mr. Rogers. Yes, Mr. Rogers. Mr. Rogers left his neighborhood, which he does every so often, and he came to New York, to the big city. And he asked me if I thought the children would mind if he came up to visit them. And I said, no, I don't think they'll mind. And so we went up together. And we went on the train, the number 6 train, same way I always go. Mr. Rogers on the New York subway, there he was. No stretch limousine for Mr. Rogers. And alas, no trolley, not New York. Went on the subway, and he didn't have his slippers or his sneakers, and he didn't have his sweater, but he had a bow tie. And he was the same wonderful man that little kids have loved for 40 years now. And you know that Mr. Rogers is a minister? He was ordained in the Presbyterian Church. He was ordained with a ministry to children, and he's fulfilled that beautifully, I think. On the train going up to the Bronx, I kept thinking, this nation is so divided racially. What if nobody knows him? What if the kids, he's just another white European male, like me, you know, the old white man. And nobody knows him, and I got sort of scared, or that people would resent us or something, would resent him. Baloney. I got off the train with him. We went upstairs to the street. We walked one block in the South Bronx, and a sanitation truck came screeching to a halt. The driver jumped out, a man in his 50s, a big guy, and lifted Mr. Rogers right off the ground. Then we went to the public school. I always visit this good public school that I like in the South Bronx, and the wonderful principal, and we visited with the little ones, the little kids in a bilingual kindergarten, and had a great time. And then at the end of school, we went to the church where the kids go after school. Well, we stopped to chat with the teachers, so by the time we got there, all the kids were at the church, and the place was packed. Elio spots Mr. Rogers from across the room. When he sees someone he likes, he goes right at you. He's like, he reminds me of a World War II attack plane, and like a jet-powered bumblebee. And he goes right at you with his wings out wide, and just at the moment of collision with Mr. Rogers, he wraps his arms around him, gives him a big hug, kisses him, says, welcome to my neighborhood, Mr. Rogers. Forget that. After Mr. Rogers left, the children had a big debate about how old he was. They're very compassionate. They worry about grown-ups, and these are not selfish children. They have a right to be selfish because they don't get much of the good stuff in this country. But they are unselfish. They're generous. They always worry about older people, whatever our race. And they had a big debate over how much gray hair Mr. Rogers had. And one girl said, I know he had gray hair because I touched it. And the other one was defending Mr. Rogers' eternal youth and said, no, it was black. They do the same with me. They climb up all around me. There's one little one named Raven who's so small she has to stand on a chair next to where I'm sitting, so she's level with my head. And then she studies it, and she tugs at gray hairs when she finds them, and she says, uh-oh, every time she finds one. And, you know, Elio gets on the other side of me, and he studies me, you know, like he looks in my ears and my nostrils like a horse, you know, to see how old it is. First time I ever met him, I said, how old are you, Elio? He said, I'm 6. How old are you? Oh, I said, I'm 60, because I was then. I said, I'm 60. He immediately crossed himself. He said, Jonathan, I hope you don't die. And then he went to tell the priest that I'm 60. I want to make clear to you that little kids like Elio are not unique. They're not unusual exceptions. They're not poster children for the poor. There are millions of poor children like them of all races all over the United States. And the tragedy with the poorest ones is not just that these little kids are cheated of so many of the good things that a rich democracy could give to all its children, but that our society itself is cheated of the gifts these kids could give us. I mean, that's the ultimate price. I know so many wonderful little children, I just think how many poems will never be written, how many songs will never be sung, because these children will never have a chance to light their little lights in public. Some people describe the kids I write about as miracles. And I use that term sometimes too, because it seems like a miracle that they can be so clean amidst all the filth we dump on them. And so I'll sometimes say, yes, these children are little miracles. Trouble is that a good society can't really be built on miracles, because they don't happen all the time. It can only be built on systematic justice. And there isn't any systematic justice for the poorest children in this nation. Even in something as empirical and obvious and easy to measure as education finance, children in poor places like the South Bronx, as in large stretches of Wisconsin and Ohio and New Hampshire and Missouri and Kansas and straight across this country, are miserably cheated. I'll stick with New York because I happen to have the numbers available. You can fill in the numbers for your part of the country. New York spends about $6,000 yearly on each little boy or girl in third grade. That might sound fairly high to some of you, but don't forget the cost of living in New York. That's equivalent to about 4,000 in Kansas in buying power. $6,000 yearly on the poorest little children in America, like Elio. There are all sorts of arguments about school finance, but I know this number is true because it was in the New York Times. Besides, the school chancellor in New York told me that figure. $6,000 for these desperately poor children who need so much more than most other kids do. You take Elio in your grown-up arms and you plunk him down within a classroom in the richest suburbs of New York, and he'll be getting $16,000 every year spent on his public education. And he'll probably be getting a teacher who receives $15,000 to $20,000 more per year. And he'll be in a classroom with nearly half as many children. We say that in the eyes of God, all children are of equal worth, and in the eyes of God, I'm sure that's true, but not in the eyes of America. In the eyes of America, Elio is a $6,000 baby. If we want to see a $16,000 baby, we have to rent a car and drive out to the suburbs. Ah, but if Elio grows up illiterate, unemployable, unable to hold down a decent job because he never got the education he deserves, and if in desperation or longing for revenge, he goes out in the street someday and commits a terrible crime and puts a knife in someone's heart and ends up at Rikers Island, then we'll spend real money. $64,000 every year to keep a man at Rikers Island. If he's still a boy when that happens, in juvenile detention, $93,000 a year in New York City, $6,000 to educate him as a third grade student. What good society, what smart society, what genuinely Judeo-Christian society would ever spend 10 times as much to penalize a human being as it would to bless him when he's still a baby, innocent and clean? I don't know the answer to that question. Now, Now, I have friends, the same old friends I told you about before, who will agree with me on almost everything I say, except this one business about money. They don't believe that money really makes a difference, although, of course, they spend it for their own children. They'll say to me, this even happens with Congress, because I testify occasionally in front of a House or Senate committee. I've done this, I haven't done it recently because I find it so exhausting and frustrating, but I have done it many times in the past. And even there, presumably intelligent people wonder whether money really would make a difference in the education of poor children. And I've testified in front of a Senate committee where at the end, they'll come up, when the C-SPAN camera's gone, you know, they come up and they'll give me a hug, some of them, even the Republicans, you know, they'll reach for that elbow again. And they'll say, Jonathan, that was really moving. It was very, very moving stuff, you know. They'll say, Jonathan, as though they know me. No, I don't know them. I wouldn't say Orin. Jonathan, he says, oh, they know me. And they're flattering, and they seem to like me. You know, you really can't make them mad at you. And I guess they like me because I dress the way they do, because I seem respectable to them or something. But so they'll say it moved them, but then there's this funny moment where they'll step back a bit, and I can see they're gonna hedge their bet. And then I always know what's coming. This question, it's always the same question. I'll say, it's very upsetting what you had to say just now. Just tell me one thing. Is money really the answer? And you know, I'm always amazed that presumably educated people, you know, and there are some people in the Senate who can read, and understand and comprehend, you know, quite a few of them, probably most of them. It's amazing that people who were educated could seriously consider it bizarre to suggest that money is the answer to poverty. And that they think it's strange, you know, and they'll say, can you really solve these kinds of problems by throwing money at them? And I always say throwing, you know. And I always say, sure, that's the way to do it. Throw it. Dump it from a helicopter. You give it to me, I'll bring it there myself. I don't know a better way to put the roof on a collapsing school, or a better way to take a wonderful, glowing, idealistic young teacher just out of college who loves the children and has been there for 2 years and pay her enough to guarantee that she will stay there for a lifetime. See, that's where money counts. And yet, they always ask me this, and they'll, you know, and my friends in New York, these guys don't just send their kids to the most expensive suburban high schools. Many of them send their kids to prep schools. And I mean not just any old prep school. They send them to New England prep schools that are very, very expensive. I mean schools like Andover and Exeter and Groton and St. Paul's, where presidents have been educated, and presidential candidates, alas, also. And I mean, you know, these are the schools where they go. And you know what those schools cost, where my friends send their kids? I know, because I recently had to fight to get one of the South Bronx kids into one of those schools. Those schools now cost $29,000 to $35,000 a year. That's what the meritocracy pays to guarantee that their merit will be hereditary. You know, that's what they pay. And these friends of mine who spend $30,000 or more to send their kids to be schooled to perfection at schools like Phillips Exeter Academy in Groton, will seriously look me in the eyes and say, can you really buy your way to better education for poor people? You know, and I say to them, I'm not a nasty guy. I'm polite. I look them in the eyes and I just shake my head and say, I don't know. It seems to work for your kid, doesn't it? You know, what, and you know, and some of the real ideological ones, the ones who, you know, the Heritage Foundation types, will go at you a different way. They'll say, is there any data to prove that equal investment will bring equal results? And they say, you know, maybe the investment won't pay off. You know, maybe there are too many other factors here. Maybe these children have so many other things going against them that the money alone won't make a difference. And whenever I hear that, and I hear that a lot, I always give the answer that a wonderful state judge in New Jersey gave some years ago when he found the funding system for public education in New Jersey constitutionally illegal. An eloquent judge. If money does not guarantee success in education, said the judge, then the poor have an equal right with the rich to be disappointed by that discovery. That's wonderful. I don't think these savage inequalities that I've described can be dismissed as simply minor imperfections in our system of taxation or school finance. I think they're worse than that. I think they're evil theologically. You know, I'm always cautious, being Jewish, to quote with abandon from the other part of the Bible, but I do read both sections. And so does my mother, too. And I love the Gospels. I love the Christian Gospels. And I think I know them pretty well. When Jesus said to Simon Peter, if you love me, feed my sheep, he didn't say only the sheep who live in the green pastures. He didn't say only the sheep whose mothers please us by acceptable behavior. He didn't say only the sheep whose mothers have good jobs and make smart choices and show up for PTA. He didn't say only the sheep that have two parents in the pen. He just said, feed my sheep. Oh, I love preaching to the Christians, but, you know. I figure as a Jew, it's in a good tradition. I want to end this on a personal note. I've gotten to know a lot of the young people here, and you have wonderful young people here. There's so much idealism among the students here. I mean, you really have wonderful students here, the ones I've met. And a lot of the young people are kind of, they're very idealistic now, but I know what happens. A lot of young people, after a few years, once out of college, they start to get worried because their parents are worried about them, and their parents want them to do something that's secure in life. And that can be a very constrictive force for young people who are full of idealism, and more so than most young people want to admit. Let me tell you a little story. My closest friend in the South Bronx died a couple years ago. Her name was Alice Washington. I wrote about her in Amazing Grace, and those of you who read the book, I'm sure, will not forget her. She was a wonderful woman, proud, courageous, prophetic, with a beautiful face made wise by suffering and seasoned by endurance. She died of AIDS after a struggle of 10 years. But during those last years, she just kept on fighting back. And she never gave in. She had this terrific sense of humor and this wonderful wit and sarcasm that rescued her from misery, even at the hardest times. She just kept falling down and getting up again. An Episcopal priest I met in New Jersey a couple of years ago had a wonderful way of talking about people like Alice. He talks about the way that people rise above their problems and their inclinations to despair. He calls it ordinary resurrections. He points out that the origin of resurrection is a Greek word meaning standing up again. And as he puts it unpretentiously, we all fall down, we all rise up, we do this every day. Same word is used by Christ, of course, as he notes, I am the resurrection and the life. But in a charming little note directed probably at fellow members of the clergy, he observes, the resurrection does not wait for Easter. I always think of ordinary resurrections now when I remember Alice Washington. I loved her, and I never felt I came to her with gifts to give as great as those she gave. I've never gone into poor communities with this thought that I had a big bag of colonial blessings to sprinkle amongst them, you know, straight from Harvard Square. I go in search of blessings, and I find them every day and every night. But now she's gone. I thought of her very much the way I think of my own mother. My mother's 95 years old. She'll be 96 one month from now, God willing. Still cogent, still tyrannical. Whenever I forget to call, I come back from New York late at night, occasionally after I've been there for a week, and if it's not too late, I'll stop by her house to say hi, and if it's midnight, she gets out of bed and says, sit down and eat. Jewish mother, but then I realized a Jewish mother is absolutely the same as a Puerto Rican mother, and a Mexican-American mother, and a black mother, and a Lutheran mother even, you know. She's a mother, and she insists on the right to tyrannize and humiliate her son, you know. And she's an old liberal, too, my mother is. She's a real old-fashioned liberal. She's angry as hell at Bill Clinton, not for his personal behavior, but for what she calls his sellout of the poor in signing the welfare bill. My mother's not a neoliberal. She's not an ex-liberal. She's not a tired liberal. She's not an embarrassed liberal. She's not a defeated liberal. She's still the real thing. She's, being from Boston, of course, she's also a baseball fanatic, you know. Loves the Boston Red Sox. My mother has lived almost an entire century. She was 14 years old in junior high school when the Red Sox won the last World Series, you know? And she's waiting to see it happen again. When I was in the fight for civil rights, when I was a young teacher, my mother got scared, and so did my father, and so would your parents, any of you, if you got involved in the kind of thing that changed my life. See, my mother and father are really good people. I mean, they were old-fashioned FDR Democrats, and they cheered for the civil rights movement, and they admired the young people who went down to Mississippi, black and white, and risked their lives for justice. But when I decided to become a fourth grade teacher in a ghetto school and moved over to live in the black community, my mother got worried. She got scared. And, you know, partly I understand why. Because my father was a very poor kid. He grew up in the ghetto, it was a Jewish ghetto in those days, part of Boston called Roxbury. And his mother was an immigrant from Russia. He was very poor, and he worked his heart out to get out of the ghetto, to get into Harvard College. And he went to law school, and then he changed his mind, went to medical school, and became a doctor.
He became
a psychiatrist. So naturally, suddenly he was rich, and he moved out to the suburbs. And then I was born. I came along when everything was easy. And naturally, they just walked me into Harvard. When I was ready to go to college, I wanted to go to Princeton. My father panicked, you know. He took me to the Dean of Admissions at Harvard, and the Dean of Admissions talked me into going to Harvard. I applied to one college, Harvard, knowing I'd get in. Ah, the affirmative action of the rich. They never talk about that kind. And after Harvard, by some mistake, I became a Rhodes Scholar. I say it was a mistake because Rhodes Scholars are supposed to be athletes, and I never passed my swimming test. But I was good at holding a sherry glass, and after 4 years at Harvard, I had a beautiful fake British accent, and I was good at my interview, and I went off to Oxford, but I hated Oxford. It was too much like Harvard. So I left. I didn't stay very long. I went to Paris for a Christmas vacation, and the first week in Paris, by some extraordinary accident, I happened to make friends with an older American writer, a wonderful man named James Jones, who wrote the World War II classic, From Here to Eternity. And Jim and his wife took me in and basically fed me that winter, and they introduced me to all the great American writers who were in Paris then, William Styron. I bumped into Richard Wright in a bookstore one night, the great Richard Wright. And I met Henry Miller, too, though I didn't tell my mother. And I was living in the same hotel that Allen Ginsberg had been living in, and William Burroughs, so I didn't want to go back to Oxford. And I didn't, and I stayed in Paris for a few years, and finally I returned to the United States. And when I came back to the States, my father was panicked because I was now 27 years old, and you know, Rhodes Scholars are supposed to do something important in life. And I was just hanging around Cambridge, and my father would take me out to lunch. He'd take me to the faculty club at the university, and he'd look me in the eyes, and he'd say, "Son, are you okay?" And I can guess now how he felt. You know, he thought a Rhodes Scholar by that age would have done something significant. At very least, I'd be the governor of an unimportant state, you know. And then, to his despair, in the summer of 64, after those three kids were murdered in Mississippi in the freedom struggle, I went over and joined the civil rights movement. And in the fall, I became a school teacher, substitute teacher, to his dismay. You know, I had lunch with him again at the faculty club, and I said, "Dad, at least I have a job now." And he said, "What is it?" And I said, "I'm a sub." You know. And a few weeks later, they made me permanent sub, and I told him that, and he wasn't impressed. And the year ended unexpectedly. My first year as a teacher, I went on to teach more afterwards, but my career in the Boston schools ended the following June, a week before the end of the school year, when I was fired. I was fired for the oddest reason. I was frustrated that the kids in my classroom had no literature that had anything to do with black children. It was that old, boring Scott Forsman Basel reader that we're still stuck with today, only now it's got a few brownish pictures in it. It's a multi-ethnic version, but in those days there was nothing. And I hated it, not just because it was racist, because it was really boring. So one day in the spring, to try to wake up my class, I went over to Harvard and I just grabbed a new book out of the bookstore, Poetry and Langston Hughes. And I brought it into school and I read one poem from that. And I'll never forget that day, because a little girl in my class who had never talked to me the whole year, this was a group of kids that had endless substitute teachers ever since they entered school, which happens today in New York again, in these ghetto schools. This little girl who had never talked to me started to cry when I read this Langston Hughes poem. It's a beautiful poem that some of you probably know. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun? A great, great poem. And she started to cry and came up and asked me if she could bring the book home to show her mother. And she took it home, and the next day she came in and asked if she could recite it to the class. She'd memorized it overnight. And the next day I was fired from the Boston schools because Langston Hughes wasn't on the curriculum for fourth grade. They have lists. You know these lists they make? Children at fourth grade level can read this, but not that. And so, and they said Langston Hughes was a ninth grade poet and could not be read in fourth grade. Now, I didn't know that because I was a sub, you know. They don't tell you any of that stuff. So I was out, and it was a big story. It was on the front page of the newspaper. Rhodes Scholar fired from fourth grade. And, but formal charge against me was wonderful. The charge was curriculum deviation. Funny way the United States works. One month later, I was hired by the federal government for curriculum development. And I went to work for Upward Bound. But in the meantime, it was a big event in Boston. And the parents of the kids in my class were so angry at what the school system did. And I mean, these were loyal people. A lot of white folks used to say, don't stick out your neck for those people. They'll never fight for you if you get in trouble. But they did. You know, we never could get more than 20 or 30 people to a PTA meeting at that school because the parents didn't like the principal. I didn't either, and I even less after she fired me. But it was hard to get parents to show up for PTA because they didn't think it was going to change anything. But the night that I was fired, the parents of the kids in my class knocked on every door in the neighborhood, and that night 300 people packed the local church. And the next day they shut down the school, a sit-in where they sat in their children's chairs. And the following week, they announced they were going to shut down the whole school system in alliance with other groups all over the city, not because of me at this point, but in order to protest the savage inequalities and segregation of our schools. And they said, you have to come and speak at this demonstration we're going to have. And I was terrified because I didn't want to, I used to tremble in public, and I didn't want to be a part of history. I wanted to watch history on television, narrated by Walter Cronkite, you know. I didn't want to have to enter the stage. I would shake when I had to do anything in public. And at the church that night, the head of the NAACP, you know, put his arm around me and he said, come on, brother, you have to speak. And I was so scared, I started to cry. So I didn't know what to say. And I was moved that they would do that. You know, it was a moving experience. That now there's this big demonstration downtown. And they said, you have to come and lead the march. Oh my God. So I was scared of what this was going to do to my parents. That's the whole point of the story. I wasn't ever afraid of getting beaten over the head by a racist sheriff, because we didn't have that in Boston. That was Mississippi. I wasn't afraid the Ku Klux Klan was going to kill me, because, you know, they weren't active in Boston, or if they were, they didn't have their sheets, you know. They wore blue suits, probably, but I wasn't afraid of any of those things. And I'll be honest with you, I wasn't afraid that I'd never get another job. Because we all know when we have our credentials, you know, you can take plenty of risks and you're going to rise again. I was afraid that this was going to humiliate my parents. Because my parents were middle class people. My mom dressed very respectably. She wore a sensible suit from Saks Fifth Avenue. And sensible shoes from Lord & Taylor, and she's a sensible woman, and I was terrified. What's this going to do to them? On top of everything else, the school superintendent in Boston was my father's classmate from high school, and they used to have lunch with each other once a week for 30 years until then, you know. So I was really frightened, And the night of this big demonstration, I was too scared to drive, so my girlfriend drove me. I had a white VW Bug, you know, plastered probably with goofy political slogans. And thank God she could drive me. I've been blessed to know strong women in my life. And she drove me there, and I still remember we parked illegally at the foot of Beacon Hill, which is a site of Revolutionary War battles. I still park illegally at that same spot, as a matter of fact. And then we had to walk up the hill. And there were so many people, there were thousands of people, you could hear them singing and clapping their hands before you could see them. And there were television cameras, and they were singing what we used to call freedom songs, songs of struggle. Some of you sing them in church as gospel songs, beautiful songs. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, I'm gonna let it shine, I'm gonna let it shine. Just like a tree standing by the water, we shall not be moved. Beautiful songs. You could hear these voices in the night over the Boston Common with all of history resonating behind it. And we walked up that hill and they were coming right at us. And I was scared stiff, and I remember I thought I was going to throw up. I was so nervous. And just as the line came towards us, my girlfriend stopped and grabbed my elbow again. And this time, she squeezed it because she started to cry, because on the front of the line coming right towards us was this beautiful woman, Ellen Jackson, who was the leader of the civil rights movement in Boston, an extraordinary black woman, our sojourner truth, our prophet in Boston, this beautiful black mother who was fighting for her children. And on her left arm was my mother. And on her right arm was my father. They didn't call, they didn't scold me, they didn't scare me, they just came out to join the revolution. I owe to my memory of that night whatever courage I still have today. My mother's a frail woman now, but she still helps me and she still scolds me. And to be honest, I can't bear the thought of losing her. I pray just like a six-year-old that she'll live forever. But I know she can't. My friends, none of us can. We all know we're gonna die. And we all know we'll lose the ones we love the most to death. The old trees and the playfulness of children will outlive us all. Life goes too fast. Use it well. God bless you. Good luck.
Keep it tight. Do you want to invite the first one?
I will. Mr. Kozol has agreed to take a few minutes of questions, and I think I see a microphone over there, and there are two down here that I see. So if there are any questioners, there's your spots. Yes, sir.
Mr. Kozol, that was really moving. Dr. Muhammad Yunus from the Grameen Bank in Bangladesh 2 years ago started calling for an international movement to end poverty.
Who called for that?
Dr. Muhammad Yunus. He has the Grameen Bank where he gives small loans to women in Bangladesh. And Bill Bradley, of course, is our presidential candidate who's kind of really led that movement here in the United States. And I'm wondering what role you see yourself playing in that movement and what advice you give to others who might want to be a part of building that movement.
Well, I give my support pretty much without even checking to almost every group that's doing anything like that on an international level. I'm one of those naive people whose life is very hectic, and so when I get faxes from groups I've absolutely never heard of that tell me they're interested in assuring the decent care or survival of children in Haiti or Afghanistan, wherever, I almost always, and they say, will you sign this 17-page petition if you agree with it? There's no time to read it, so I just write, yeah, sure, and I send it back. And so in that sense, I assume that I would, I would support the man you just referred to in his cause also. And I don't mean to be patronizing, it's just I don't want to make every, I don't want to have to spell out the name to pronounce it right. But the real thing is that we don't need to choose between being a generous country to the kids in our midst and also being decent to those in other countries, because we're in this unprecedented, luxurious situation of being the wealthiest, most powerful nation in the world. I mean, no other nation has ever had the opportunity that we have today. And it's just extraordinary. It's sort of this limitless capacity for decency that's now within our hands, within our reach. And by the way, when I said earlier in my talk, I made an allusion to Judeo-Christian values. I did not mean to exclude any other religious groups. I just want to make sure that's clear. I just can't add enough hyphens and keep the rhythm of my sentence going. But I would add them all if there were time. What I mean is, whether you think of it as probably many of you do because of your upbringing as Christian values or as Old Testament values or whatever, we're in this unique position where we know we're now the most powerful nation in the world, the greatest nation in the world in that sense, and we have the opportunity also to be a truly good nation. And there's all this potential goodness in America, and it's just not quite realized yet. And we have tremendous obligations abroad, but within our own land, we have this one continuing gnawing area of terrible failure, and it's that we have never truly crossed this racial divide. I mean, that the racial divide, when it's combined with economic injustice, is really our special wound as a nation, our self-inflicted wound, and our crucifixion, our terrible slow bleeding. And we haven't dealt with it yet. We're now at the end of a century since Plessy versus Ferguson. How many of you studied about Plessy in school? Oh, hooray. I knew this was a sophisticated city. Oh, great. Well, 101 years to be exact. It wasn't Plessy 1898, maybe it was 96, whatever, roughly 100 years since Plessy, and we're still separate and still unequal. And so we were not even really up to Plessy. Forget about Brown, if you can, being so close to Topeka. But this is our special sin. And then there are all the international areas of moral delinquency. But I don't know, I just had this thought that I'd like to live long enough to see our nation finally address this one issue. I mean, and accept small blessings and hope that maybe we could win this one. There are a lot of people in America who really are of goodwill and don't like living with the knowledge that their own victories are won at the expense of others. They don't like it. A lot of wealthy kids who go to expensive suburban schools in areas like, what's the county here, Johnson County, is it? It's very affluent. Kids who go to schools in neighborhoods like that, or at New Trier High outside Chicago, which I wrote about, they write me moving letters. They say they don't like growing up with the idea that all their victories in life will be contaminated because they know they were won in a game that was rigged unfairly. There's a basic sense of fair play in America. We wouldn't play Little League the way we run our education and healthcare systems in this country. So I just keep hoping that before I die, I can somehow find, you know, the right note, the right mystery, the special brand of holy water, you know, that'll make this happen, this one thing. That's really all I long for. Is there a woman there who had a question?
Yeah, I was just going to ask you, earlier you mentioned that compared to places where usually are, Lawrence seemed like a utopia, but I'm sure you'll agree that there are a lot of problems here.
I know there are.
Yeah, I was just wondering what kind of problems you think that these perceived utopias, especially here in Kansas, struggle with. Are they the same as ones in the Bronx, or are they different?
Well, I know there are a lot of homeless people here, and I know they're not simply people who are alcoholics, although many homeless people do have substance problems, but some of them are simply very poor women who have had a rotten deal in life and have to flee from a bad situation, a bad marriage, and have no place to go and no money, and they end up at the mercy of a handful of decent kids here on campus who will actually feed them and help them out. That's a constant. You also have a great deal of unfairness in the way children are assigned to schools on the basis of residence, which also in this state inevitably means on the basis of economics. You have schools that have, you know, 80-90% low-income children who qualify for food stamps and or free lunch, and then schools that have scarcely any such children. And whether they're white or black or brown or Native American or Asian immigrants, you know, whatever the origin, it's a shame we do this, because that's sort of a continual betrayal of the idea of America. I mean, those two things are constants. There's also a great deal of inequity in school finance in this state, even though on paper it looks pretty good. I don't want to go on and on and you know, just berate everybody here who's been so nice to me, because it seems it's not your fault. It's the fault of everybody outside this building, you know. But honestly, if I knew a lot about Kansas, don't worry, I wouldn't be polite. And I would say what it is, but I don't know enough in this short time I've been here. I've had a long experience with the situation in Missouri and in St. Louis, and in Kansas City, Missouri, and in East St. Louis, Illinois, that area. I have studied at great length. And if you want to see without going to the South Bronx, if you want to see sort of a monument to enduring, unimaginable apartheid in America, you go to East St. Louis. I mean, that's not very far. And you go and just see an entire city of people, poor, black, some doing pretty well despite everything. Those are the little miracles. But an awful lot of people not doing well at all because they're so badly shortchanged. And that's a terrible embarrassment to our nation. We have to change that. I hope the young people here will change that. In the 60s, I thought that by the 80s, there wouldn't be any racial problem in America. I thought we were all going to marry each other, you know? Well, that didn't quite happen. I can remember around 1968, the headmasters of all the elite schools in Massachusetts used to call me up and ask me if I would send them minority kids, because they were all embarrassed that their schools were lily white. And I sometimes felt that I was in sort of a perverse form of the slave trade, you know, because they said, we'll bid for that one, you know. We were sending minority kids. I always did this with the advice of black leaders, because I, you know, you remember the words that a surgeon knows, first do no harm. you want to be careful you don't put a kid into a bad situation. But usually the black leaders would say, good Lord, you know, life is rough no matter where you go to school. Why not have it rough at Exeter? And now you're going to get into a good college, you know. So, you know, I thought with that optimism, I thought, oh, we're going to have this problem licked in 20 years, and then we'll deal with the problems of the rest of the world. It didn't happen. So it's in the hands of the young people here to do it. And I just pray that some of you will do it in your lifetimes. And I hope I'll live to see it, the beginning of it at least. Should we do one last or two last questions? Okay, good.
Go for it.
Either.
You were there first.
You first, because you're on the left, okay? Go ahead.
Okay, I'm wondering what lessons can we learn, or what lessons can the public school system learn from the successes of the private school systems?
I don't think very much, to be honest, because I'll tell you what, I didn't mean to be sarcastic at all, but when I was in secondary school, my father sent me to a private school. So I spent 6 years in the democratic system and 6 years in the other system. And here to be useful is what I would say you could learn from private schools. You could learn the virtues of a very small class size. The best private schools in New England, and probably in most of the country, you know, typically in third grade they have maybe 16, at most 18 children in a class. 18 is a lot. Little Elio, whom I described, has 30 in his class. There are classes in the South Bronx that start the year with 45 or 50. You know, you can say what you want about money, whether money counts or not, but everybody in the world knows that if you doubled the money that you're spending on little Elio, you'd have enough money to split that class into two classes of 16 kids each and hire the best teacher away from the most fancy suburb to come in and teach those children. And you know, that's what money can buy, and that's something we can learn from private schools. We can also learn from good private schools, at least the ones I know in New England, that it's wonderful for children to be surrounded by a physically beautiful environment, to know, among other things, that when you go to school, you're going into a place that's physically the most attractive place that you ever see during the course of a week. For most inner city kids, the school is the ugliest place they ever see. You can also learn a good deal from good private schools, the kind I like, about the informality that's possible on a teacher's part when a school is when a class is small enough and a school is small enough, so there's no sense of desperation. Big, crowded classes in big, underfunded schools tend to force the teacher to assume the role of a cop. It forces us to be disciplinarians more than most of us would like to be. And you have no choice, because otherwise all hell will break loose. So, I mean, I've been in situations in the inner city where most of you probably think of me as an old progressive type of teacher, which is what I like to feel I am. You know, my friends were writers like John Holt, and my heroes were writers like Eric Erickson and Robert Coles and Jean Piaget, and you know, that's my model of education. But when I'm in a big, big class with three or four kids who are crawling the walls, and I don't have the time or the resources to give to every child, I can sound just as mean as William Bennett, you know? And I can be just as much of a bully as he is. And I don't like that. So, I mean, that's the glory of the wealthier private schools, is that teachers can retain their personalities. Teachers can still have fun with children, which is, you know, teachers can glory in the children. Teachers can be like the good priest in her Sunday robe sprinkling holy water. They can glow in the presence of the children. Education at its most wonderful isn't simply delivering proficiencies. It's one part poetry and one part ministry. And education at its best is like an epiphany. It's serving the bread and wine every day, the whole year long. And that, you know, that's what's possible in a beautifully financed school and with lovely conditions for the children, and all our children deserve that. Last question, okay?
You've done the really courageous work of putting, you know, these issues before us and giving voice to these kids that, you know, and the situation, and I'm just wondering what suggestions you have for dealing with what seems to me to be a really root problem here, that there's so much selfishness in the culture, and, you know, it's going to take a lot to motivate to get our legislators to do what's necessary to eradicate that $10,000 difference that you're talking about. I mean, how do we address that? Because until we, you know, until we get people motivated to want to deal with that, I mean, this is how this thing has persisted for 100 years.
You know what I think? First of all, the young people I meet are not at all as selfish as the media would lead you to believe they are. I mean, I just think there's a lot more idealism and unselfishness among young people than these sort of stereotypes we hear about on television or read in the magazines, where everybody is just, you know, all they want is to, you know, more commodities from the Gap. That's probably passé by now. The awful thing about young people is that as soon as I think I've caught up with the fashions, I'm always 2 years late. You mean like, I mean, I've just caught up with gigapets. Do you know what they are? And nobody plays with them anymore. Now I figured them out. Now it's Pokemon, and I don't even understand that. So the thing is, I think, I mean, maybe this is just the doddering hope of an old guy, but I travel a fair amount, and I meet a lot of regular people, not just the, you know, the 2,000 liberals in Lawrence, Kansas or Ann Arbor who get together with me when I'm in town, but I meet a lot of regular, you know, folks who just, people who are waiters and waitresses and taxi drivers and everything, and I talk, and business leaders, yes, I meet them too, and doctors and lawyers and newspaper publishers, and I get the sense that there's a lot of basic goodness in this country and a lot of sort of a longing for unselfishness, and it doesn't seem to translate itself into political action. I mean, I really don't think this is a nation of 260 million selfish little people, you know, who just, who all they care about is their own good and nobody else's. I think most Americans, if they met Elio, the little boy I described, would want to give him the world. I think most Americans would, except for a handful, you know, like Pat Buchanan, maybe. I don't know. But, you know, maybe he has a bigger heart than anyone realizes, though I wouldn't bet on it. But the thing is, I mean, I just get this sense that there's a lot of goodness in this country. I mean, I go to Christian churches all the time because, you know, that's my destiny in life, you know. An agnostic Jew who's always sitting there in front of communion and not sure what he should do about it, you know. But as one of the nuns calls me, she calls me a recovering agnostic, the funny term. I see an awful lot of people who take their religion seriously. You know, I don't think this is a nation of Christian hypocrites. You know, I think an awful lot of Christians and Hindus and Buddhists and Jews are sincere in their religion. And Quakers, of course, are, I was going to say, almost insufferably sincere. No, I love the Quakers. They're my allies everywhere I go. It's just the Quakers and the Unitarians are so persistently earnest. Sometimes I yearn for cynicism when I'm with them. But they've been my lifelong political friends, so I don't mean to tease them. But the thing is, there's a lot of goodness in this country, and there's something bizarre which makes it impossible to translate this into massive political action. I don't know why. I mean, every so often, we do translate it into good political action. There are some good governors in this country. Possibly you have one of them. I don't know anything about this guy. But there are some states where I've actually met the governor, and people have said, this guy is really working his heart out to deliver on what children need. There are some members of the Senate who are really good human beings. My great hero is an ex-professor named Paul Wellstone, who's just a wonderful man, you know. And there are others. And if, you know, I've met some Republican Congress members who I thought were really good people who wanted to do what was right in life. But there's some reason why this does not get translated into the political process. I mean, if anybody can ever figure out how is it that Clinton, you know, husband and wife, who much of their life were allied with the most progressive causes serving children in this country, whose closest political friends, I was told, were Marion Edelman and Peter, great Marion Edelman of the Children's Defense Fund. How could it be that this man ends up, through the bizarre workings of the political process, signing the bill that ends the gift that Franklin Roosevelt gave our children, which was that the federal government would guarantee their entitlement to a healthy, decent childhood? And how is it that he could have signed that welfare bill to end it? If you can ever figure that out, please don't email me, because I can't do that yet, but call me and tell me how. The mystery for me is, you know, how we can turn the potential goodness of this country into an enacted goodness in the political arena. We can do it. There's no reason why we have to have the situation where in every city you can get off the plane and you can say to your host, as I often do, where do the black people live in this town? And he'll drive me there within 5 minutes. But before he points it out, I know where it is, because that's the place where instead of banks, there are signs that say check cashing here. You know, because that's part of the institutional racism of America. The banks don't think it's worth serving minority communities, so they pay every time they cash a check and get no savings. That can be changed. There's no reason why these insidious things go on. And I won't pretend to know more than I do. If I knew the answer to that, I'd be running for president right now. You know, why let Bill Bradley do it, you know? He wasn't the smartest Rhodes Scholar. And, if I knew the answer, I'd run too. I don't know the answer. I think the best role I can have is to keep asking the questions and to try to force the questions. I can force the questions, and it's easier for me to do it than for many people in this room who are on the faculty, for example, because nobody can deny me tenure. You know, I can't be fired anymore. I'm too old to worry about that. There's nothing they can do to me anymore. So I can keep asking the questions, and that's what I intend to do. And if any of the young people here ever find the answers, please come and tell me. And any of you who end up in Massachusetts, you're always welcome to come and visit me and my dog. We will make you welcome. And thank you very much.
Some of them coming to this reception.
I think so. Mr. Kozol, Jonathan, thank you for being so generous with your time, so generous with your thoughts, so generous with your passion. And thanks to all of you for your earnest listening and participation. Good night, and enjoy the rest of your weekend.